assisted by our deacon, brother, Stephen Channing. My name is Eric Sonnet. I'm very proud to serve as a proclaimer of the word this afternoon. I'd also like to thank you all for adhering to the policy, the face mask policy of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts and the Archdiocese of Boston. Thank you so much for your adherence to the face mask. This afternoon, our celebration will be very reserved in honor of the crucifixion of our Lord. And I ask you now to remain seated as our celebrant and deacon join us.
Remember your mercies, O Lord, with your eternal protection. Sanctify your servant for whom Christ, your Son, by the shedding of his blood, established the Paschal mystery, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Guilt of us all. Though he was harshly treated, A grave was assigned him among the wicked, a burial place with evildoers. Though he had done nothing wrong, nor spoken any falsehood. But the Lord was pleased to crush him in infirmity. If he gives his life as no other offering for sin, he shall see his descendants in a long life, and the will of the Lord shall be accomplished through him. Because of his affliction, he shall see the light of fullness of days. Through his suffering, my servant shall justify many, and their guilt he shall bear. Therefore, I will give him his portion among the great, and shall divide the spoils with the mighty. Because he surrendered himself to death and was counted among the wicked, and he shall take away the sins of many and win pardon for their offenses. The word of the Lord. Since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has similarly been tested in every way yet without sin. So let us confidentially approach the throne of grace to receive mercy and to find grace for timely help. In the days when Christ was in the flesh, he offered prayers and supplications with written cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverence. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered, and when he was made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord.
Secretly have said nothing. Why ask me? as those who heard what I said to them. They know what I said.
When he had said this, one of the temple guards standing there struck Jesus and said,
"Is this the way you answer the high priest?"
Jesus answered him,
"If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. If I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?"
And then he sent him out to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing there keeping warm, and they said to him,
"You are not one of his disciples, are you?"
He denied it and said,
"I am not."
One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the one whose ear Peter cut off, said,
"Didn't I see you in the garden with him?"
Again, Peter denied it, and immediately the cock crowed. Then they had brought Jesus from Caiaphas to the praetorium. It was morning, and they themselves did not enter the praetorium, in order to not be defiled, so they could eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and said,
"What charge do you bring against this man?"
They answered him and said,
"If he were not a rebel, we would not have given him over to you."
At this, Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law."
The Jews answered him,
"We do not have the right to execute anyone."
In order that the word of Jesus might be fulfilled, that it was indicated the kind of death he would die. So Pilate went back into the praetorium and summoned Jesus and said to him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
Jesus answered him,
"Do you say this on your own, or have others told you about me?"
Pilate answered,
"I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the nation's priest handed you over to me. What have you done?"
Jesus answered,
"My kingdom does not belong to this world. My kingdom did belong to this world. My attendants would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not here."
So Pilate said to him,
"Then you are a king."
Jesus answered,
"You say I am a king. For this I was born, for this I came in the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice."
Pilate said to him,
"What is truth?"
Then he had this to say. He again went out to the Jews and said to them,
"I find no guilt in him, but you have a custom that I release one prisoner to you at Passover. Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?
They cried out again,
"Not this one, Barabbas."
Now Barabbas was a revolutionary, and Pilate took Jesus and had him scourged, and the soldiers wove a crown out of thorns and placed him on his head and clothed him in a purple cloak. And they came to him and said,
"Hail, hail, Jesus!"
And they struck him repeatedly. Once more, Peter went out and said to them,
"Look, I am bringing him out to you, so that you may know that I find no fault in him."
So Jesus came out, wearing a crown of thorns and a purple cloak, and Pilate said to them,
"Behold the man."
When the chief priests and the guards saw him, they cried out,
"Crucify him! Crucify him!"
Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no guilt in him."
The Jews answered,
"We have a law, and according to that law, God, because he named himself the Son of God."
Now when Pilate heard that statement, he became even more afraid, and went back into the praetorium, and said to Jesus,
"Where are you from?"
Jesus did not answer him, so Pilate said to him,
"Do you not speak to me? Do you not know that I have the power to release you and I have the power to crucify you?"
Jesus answered him,
"You would have no power over me if it had not been given to you from above. For this reason, the one who handed me over to you has the greatest sin."
Consequently, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out,
"If you release him, you are not a prisoner of Caesar. Everyone who makes it
the presentation day for Passover, and was about noon, and he said to the Jews,
"Behold your king."
They cried out,
"Take him away, take him away, crucify him."
Pilate said to them,
"Shall I crucify your king?"
The chief priests answered,
We have no king but Caesar.
And he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carried the cross himself. He went out to what is called the place of the skull, in Hebrew, Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with two others, one on either side, with Jesus in the middle. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus the Nazarene, King of the Jews." Now many of the Jews read this inscription, because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city. It was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. So the chief priests and the Jews said to Pilate,
"Do not write the King of the Jews, but that he said, 'I am the King of the Jews.'"
Pilate answered,
"What I have written, I have written."
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four shares, a share for each soldier. They also took his tunic, but the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from top down. So they said to one another,
"Let us not tear, but cast lots for it, to see who fit in me."
In order that the passage of Scripture might be fulfilled, as says, "They divided my garments among them, but for my vesture they cast lots." This is what the soldiers did. Standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother's sister, Mary the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple there whom he loved, he said to his mother,
"Behold your son."
Then he said to the disciple,
"Behold your mother."
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his house. After this, aware that everything was now finished, in order to fulfill the scripture, Jesus said,
"I thirst."
There was a vessel filled with a common wine, so they put a sponge soaked in wine on a spring of hyssop and put it up to his mouth. When Jesus had taken the wine, he said,
"It is finished."
And bowing his head, he handed over the spirit. Now, since it was the day of preparation, in order that the bodies might not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath day of that week was a solemn one, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs be broken and that they be taken down. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first, and then the other one, which was crucified by Jesus. When they came to Jesus, they saw he was already dead. They did not break his legs. And one soldier thrust his lance into his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. An eyewitness testified, and his testimony is true. He knows that he was speaking the truth, so that you may also come to believe. For this happened so that the scripture passage might be fulfilled. Not a bone of it was to be broken. And again, another passage says, "They will look upon him whom they have pierced." After this, Joseph of Arimathea, secretly a disciple of Jesus for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate if he could remove the body of Jesus, and Pilate permitted it. So they came and took his body. Nicodemus, the one who had first come to him at night, also bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus, bound it with burial cloths, along with the spices, according to the Jewish burial custom. Now the place where he had been crucified there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb, in which no one had yet to be buried. So they laid Jesus there because of the Jewish preparation, for the tomb was close by. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Just believers. Christ's body is a new temple, the dwelling place of God on earth. Its altar is his most sacred heart. And St. Peter would say in his first epistle, love covers a multitude of sin. The infinite love of Christ covers an infinite number of sins. It's not just how much he suffered that makes the cross redemptive. It's how much he loved. St. John sees the flow of blood and water. It's a visible sign of the love of God for the whole world and the love of Christ for his bride, the church.
Almighty and living God, gather what is scattered and keep together what you
consecrated may be joined together by integrity of faith and united in the bond of charity through Christ the Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for the Jewish people, to whom the Lord our God spoke first, and may grant them defense and love in his name, and faithfulness to his covenant. All.
Before you, that all may rejoice because in their hour of need, your mercy
cross, my chantless Savior of the world.
Amen, us
behold the wood of the cross on which hung the Savior of the world.
Amen.
For those that wish to adore the cross, reverence the cross, we invite you to come forward to the wood for communion. Let's just either a bow or to a genuflect before the cross.
Thank you.
Save his command of all my blind teaching, to get saved. Preserve us in the work of your mercy, that by partaking of this mystery, we may have a life unceasingly devoted to you, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our doubt for the mercy.
May abundant blessing, O Lord, we pray, descend upon your people, of honor the death of your Son, the hope of their resurrection. May pardon come, comfort be given, holy faith increase, everlasting redemption be secured.